might pop you, bus I ride you, wallet I'd steal you, lover I'd touch you, if you a grave I'd visit you, my father I'd kiss you, if you were everything but what I was, I'd come back to you again. Oh Virginia, I wanted to write about you for so very long, but you made it so hard on me. And Virginia, I never knew that to write about me I'd have to write about you too. 'Cause Dixie glows my heart and the southern sky, she lays down beside me at the end of my ride, and my accent's laid low, and I've kept you with me, and now I wanna tell the world it's what you mean to me. I'm little John Wayne's boy, and don't you forget me, I got a saddlebag of sunshine and a head full of mystery, and I'm riding out tonight with my head in my hands. I'm gonna follow you home before you see me again. Well, I've hunted in your mountains, I've fished in your sea, I've picked flowers from your fields, help my lovers tenderly. I haven't been to see you in oh so many years. I keep saying I'll find my way back, but I know that all my fears are there. Though I'm lonely and I'm free, I am lost and I am scared as well. I'm lonely and I'm free. This map don't show the words so well. I got excuses, you can probably tell. I never left what I left behind, I never found what I set out to find. I'm little John Wayne's boy, and don't you forget it, I got a saddlebag of sunshine and a heart to go with it. And I'm riding out tonight with my head in my hands. I'm gonna rectify my wrongs before the sun sees me again.
It's pouring outside. That's why Mark and I are here inside the Nag's Head Fishing Pier restaurant in a booth in Nag's Head, North Carolina. We're waiting for the rain to stop. I watch the dark swells of the ocean rise up in the large picture window over Mark's shoulders. They surge forward, push under the pier pilings, crest, and then crash right onto the beach like buffalo jumping over a cliff. We drink cups and cups and cups and cups and cups of coffee. And we chase it with chocolate. Chocolate pie and chocolate cake and chocolate ice cream and chocolate pie and chocolate cake and chocolate brownies and chocolate pie and chocolate cake and chocolate milkshakes and I'm flying. And Mark is writing poetry on paper napkins. He's pulling them from the silver dispenser like he's trying to stop himself from bleeding. Applying direct pressure with his pen. He's bobbing up and down like one of those oil-filled bobbing birds. Beep, beep. I'm bobbing right alongside with him. We're like the Olympic nose-bobbing team. I'm thinking after this buzz, we're connecting the same spirit we find when we play music together, the same one Henry Miller described when he said, "Artists receive invisible transmissions from the sensitive side of the world." Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo. Oh, man. Mark receives a transmission, all right. Beep. "Chocolate makes my heart race, man," he says. And then he puts his head down like he's an Indian in a spaghetti western. his ear by the railroad track, waiting for the train. And when he looks up, he says, "My grandfather died in his late 20s from a heart attack. I think I might die young, too." The rain finally stops. I watch it drip from the gutters. When the waitress comes with the bill, I gather all the napkins, like each one is a pair of underwear, necessary but delicate, and Mark, unable to wait for me to pay the bill, rushes out onto the beach and starts unzipping his geeky pair of parachute pants and his shorts. Huh. I remember when I was 12 or 13. I watched a girl blow up a beach ball on a family vacation in that same exact spot. She's holding the ball between her lips without using her hands. It's flopping on her chin like a bubblegum ball that's burst. Bigger and bigger. It's like by opening her mouth, she's opened up a door to allow part of herself to pass into the ball. Bigger and bigger. And when she's done, she closes the nozzle, sealing a part of herself inside. I watch her toss the ball into the air until the wind takes it and sets it into the sea, and it immediately starts riding out beyond the breakers. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, white. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, white. And then it stops, as if it has something to whisper to me. And I start to get nervous. Like, I'm in the theater beside the girl, I'm about to put my arm on the armrest beside her, and I start to count to 10. One, two, three. I tell myself at 10, I'm gonna jump up and rescue her ball. Four, five, six. She looks right at me, and I look right into the sand. Seven, six, seven, eight, nine. The ball turns, the feeling, it builds. Nine and a half. Nine and a half of a half. Nine and a half of a half of a half. 10. I grab my surfboard, and I walk right up to her.
"From the desert I come to thee, to ride my plastic stallion shod with fire, and the winds are left behind in the speed of my desire. Before thy window I stand." My voice is deep, my inflection meaningful.
"So huge," she says, "so impossible to conceive."
Are you checking this out? She may be, by all accounts, my dream girl, man. The one. Man. Actually, she doesn't speak English. And at 13, I've got nothing but a prepubescent falsetto chirp of a voice. If I said hello to her,
hello,
I most likely sound like a pterodactyl and scare her half to death. Besides, I'm turned to the side so she can't see my hideously acneed face or the bumps on my back. No, she just stares out into the water, and I press my arm into my surfboard to make my muscle look bigger. And then I just walk away, and as I throw my surfboard into the ocean and begin to float across the surface of the water, oh, everything is as it should be. I'm alone. I'm in my element, as I prefer it. I can't hear people making fun of my big nose or calling me a dirty Jew. Oh, Mother Sea, even at 13, you were there for me. And I begin to paddle for the ball. A gorgeous girl's breath is inside that ball. 1, 2, 3, 4. If I get it, she'll like me more. 1, 2, 3, 4.
I'll be the conquistador of the seashore.
1, 2, 3, 4. This will be great for my memoir. 1, 2, 3, 4. She's like an exotic Egyptian version of Drew Barrymore. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, I sit up on my surfboard. I paddle until exhausted. I've gone far enough. The beach behind me is a thin blonde line, and the girl's a tiny dot. In front of me, the ball hovers on a crest, disappears, then reappears as if to tease me, and then takes off in a rush of wind, and then it too is a tiny dot. I've gone far enough. When I get back to the beach, the girl touches my shoulder and she says,
"Something, something, 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 and thank you."
And I feel so awkward, I almost take her out at the knees with my surfboard. It's to this exact same spot that I take the napkins out to Mark. The ones that he's written his poetry on. And when I hand the napkins to him, he takes them from me, smushes them together like a sandwich, hands them back and says, "Here, man, you might need these words someday." I wonder how far I would have gone for that ball. I wonder if I had gone far enough. Would have someone come to rescue me? And then maybe someone would have had to come to rescue the person that had come to rescue me, and so on and so forth. I wonder how far anyone goes for anyone. Sometimes I wonder how far I'll go before I turn around.